All right, welcome into Sports Pit Betting Insight today. Paulie and Teddy, Tuesday, September 5th. Big game breakdown. The NFL is here. We open the season Thursday. Patriots at home against the Chiefs. And we'll also get to the Astros and the Mariners. Verlander gets the ball for the Astros. Deep dive part one of part two on NFL win totals and a best bet on the win totals and find out what Teddy played coming up. Bad beats, bad bets, bad for the books. Another horrible money line beat. College football, Georgia Tech blows a 14-point lead in the fourth quarter. You're not supposed to lose when you run 96 plays and have 655 yards of offense.
They had a 655 to 369 yard edge in total offense. So nearly 300 yards more for Georgia Tech than for Tennessee in last night's ballgame. No questions moving forward about who that Georgia Tech quarterback is going to be. Taquan Marshall stepped up. You know, he was stopped on the two-point attempt to win the game, but he ran for 244 yards and five touchdowns and also connected on five passes for 120 yards downfield. So the Yellow Jackets found their QB. They did not, however, find the victory column. Bad beat if you had Georgia Tech, a team that led by double digits twice in the second half.
All right, Cubs Pirates under 8.5. It fell 12. Bullpen shenanigans in this one late.
Yeah, it's always brutal to lose an under when one pitcher throws a shutout. You know, Cool throw, what, eight strikeouts, only four hits allowed, seven innings of work. But Jake Arrieta left early with an injury. They still had a big edge. It was 5-0, bottom of the eighth, and then Pittsburgh exploded against the bottom of the Cubs bullpen. Chicago bullpen meltdown equals really tough beat for under bettors. Yeah, under 8.5 fell 12. It was still a bad beat.
Here's some totals here. One bad bet, Giants-Rockies. Bet up from, look at this, Steve. 11.5 to 13. Never came close. Rockies win 4-3. Bet for the books. The Angels-A's total, 9.5 up to 10. Over minus 120. 11-9 final in that one. For the 10th time this year, the Angels rallied down four runs or more to win.
Yeah, I mean, the Angels games are a real headache for the odds makers right now. They've only cashed one under in their last nine ball games. And only one of those games has produced fewer than 10 runs. You know, Mike Socha is using 12 pitchers right now. He's doing a masterful job of keeping his team in the race with quite legitimately one of the worst starting rotations in all of baseball. Angels, A's cash another over ticket. Tons of steam. A bad result for the house.
And a couple more. Blue Jays, Red Sox, 8.5 to 9.5. 10-4 final. They were all over Porcello. And Hap pitched well in a 30-cent move on the Royals. They went off $1.60 favorite against the dead Tigers, who lose again.
Yeah, I mean, the Tigers are in complete free fall right now. Could even open the door for the White Sox to get out of last place. But heavy steam on Kansas City. What do we got? Five straight losses for the Tigers. And the betting bandwagon's all over fading Detroit right now. The wise guys are fading the Tigers. The public's fading the Tigers on a nightly basis. This is a team that's legitimately just playing out the string after dealing away yet another key veteran in Justin Verlander over the past couple of days.
All right, exciting news here. The Westgate in Las Vegas, the number one contest in the world. Five games against the spread, NFL games each week. This year, the winner will get over $1 million. As we tape this, they're at almost 2,400 entries. The analogy here is to compare it to the World Series of Poker. The moneymaker effect. It certainly helped last year that a Starbucks barista won and a farmer took second place. So this continues to grow. And also it helps that word is leaking out that you can use a proxy and you don't have to live in Nevada.
Of course, and there's no barriers to entry. I mean, the Super Contest is beautiful in the fact that any Joe from anywhere in the U.S., all they got to do, you got to come to Vegas once and find a proxy. You know, there are plenty of good proxies out there if you need one. Don't hesitate to whatever. Send me a tweet at Teddy_covers. I'll give you some recommendations for reputable proxies. But here's the truth of it, okay? Anyone can enter as long as you have $1,500 and you show up in Vegas once, and everybody starts 0-0. So a Starbucks barista can beat all the wise guys last year and come through in the contest. A couple of tweets here from Dave Tooley at View for Vegas. You know, as of the 4 p.m. Monday early bird deadline, which means there's a bonus $15,000 mini contest over the final 3 weeks of the season. As you mentioned, more than 2,300 entries into that. Last year, at this time, 1,576 entries. And it set a record with 1,854 entries. This year, we're going to obliterate that record, Pauly. And it's not too late. If you want to get involved in the Super Contest, you got to get to Vegas this week. But the deadline isn't until, what, Saturday? So you have plenty of time to do it. Although, you better move your butt and get out here.
They also had a new contest, the Gold, $5,000 to get in. Winner take all, which I don't like. But they're up. I put that at 32 over under. That flew over. They're at 65 as we take this. They're hoping to get 80 or more in that contest, NFL as well. Up next, the NFL season starts with the Chiefs and the Patriots on SportsBet. Betting Insight today on SBRPicks.com.
Go to SBRodds.com. Browse, compare, and shop live odds available at top online sportsbooks.
Back on SportsBet, Betting Insight today. Time for a big game breakdown. Always sponsored and powered by BetOnline. Exceptional customer service. Strong promotions and every type of wager we're looking for. Check out the bonus page at sportsbookreview.com for the latest and best offers. To open a new account today, Thursday night, NFL starts on NBC. Patriots at home against the Chiefs. They raise the banner. Patriots 8.5, 48 the total. Some new faces in New England, some trades, some people let go, and some injuries. Edelman's out for the year. Bennett went to Green Bay. You have Cooks acquired in a trade, Dorsett they just acquired in a trade, and also they bring in Dwayne Allen. Who takes Edelman's spot? Who are they going to throw to? Brady will spread it around. They also add Gillislee, running back as well. You know about Hogan and Malcolm Mitchell, they come back. So still, even with the injuries, Brady has a lot of weapons.
Oh, he sure does, no question. But the question that I have about this New England offense going into the campaign is, are we talking about a style change with this new group of receivers? Look, last year, it was all ball control, short passes. All right. I mean, it really was. I mean, look at the offense in 2016. You have Julian Edelman. What do you have? 11.3 yards per catch. You know, White at 9.2. Bennett had 12.7. It wasn't like this team was stretching the field on a consistent basis. And then you look at the guys they have this year. All right. You have Gronkowski, who would have led the NFL in yards per catch last year if he had enough catches to qualify. You have Hogan was number two. Dorsett was number eight. Cooks was number 14. Guys that averaged 16 and 15 yards per reception. So, you know, Cooks and Dorsett are very different players than Julian Edelman. And what their skill sets are and how they attack opposing defenses. You know, in my mind, this Patriots offense, I don't think they go into the season clicking the way they came out of the 2016 campaign clicking. I think it will take some time for Tom Brady to develop a nice comfort level with his new receiving core.
Then you have the Chiefs. They're always in close games with Andy Reid. Only 5 losses by more than 10 points in 67 games under Reid. They've not been a dog, but more than plus 6 in the last 49 games. The story last year and for much of the season, the last few years with the Chiefs, look at the turnover margin. They are plus 26. That is third best in the NFL. Last year they were plus 16. Usually they were outgained by their opponents, but found a way to win, Teddy.
Yeah, I mean, the Chiefs' MO has been real simple, all right? Don't screw up and force the other team into screwing up. And that's how they won all those games last year. That's how they've been a very successful team in recent seasons under Andy Reid. Smart, fundamental football, a team that doesn't beat themselves. But New England's in the same category, you know? What the Chiefs like to do against most teams, force them into making mistakes, don't make them all, or don't make themselves, don't make mistakes themselves. That doesn't happen against the Patriots. Obviously, the turnover margin graphic shows that very, very clearly with New England, one of only two teams with a better turnover margin than KC over the past 3 seasons. And, of course, you know, you have the conundrum of Alex Smith as a road dog. You know, Smith isn't going to make mistakes to put his team out of the game. As you talked about at the top, this is the Chiefs team that's only lost 5 times their last 67 games by double-digit margins. They don't get blown out very often. And that's, you know, Alex Smith not making mistakes. But when KC does fall behind and Alex Smith has to throw the football, he doesn't have the arm to pass him back in it. We've seen that plenty of times already. And, of course, you know, the Chiefs running game, you know, let's see how the rookie Kareem Hunt, who's had a pretty good preseason at Toledo, looks in the opener. You just wonder if this offense is capable of making plays on the road against this class of opponent.
All good points. You lose Ware because of the injury. You let Macklin walk. You didn't do anything to improve the team when you went 12-4. Their GM Dorsey was fired. Alex Smith lost some weapons too. I mean, do they have enough? Can they score enough in this game and for the rest of the season, really?
I mean, to me, this is a hard game because New England is a very difficult team for the quote-unquote wise guys to support. They're overvalued. I mean, everybody and their brothers betting the Patriots every week. It's just the nature of 2017 NFL. So I'm not interested in laying more than a TD with New England here, but we've seen this from the Chiefs before. When they play a team that doesn't make mistakes, Kansas City is a hard time. I know it's a lid lifter, but it's not a game that I'm going to have any action on, Paulie. Clear pass for this better.
Well, they started this in 2004 when the champs opened up at home. They've won every year but one. Remember, Baltimore lost the year after they won, but they had to play on the road in Denver. So the 2012 Giants, the only team, the only defending champs to open up at home and lose since the NFL put this new format in with the Thursday night in 2004 with the defending champs opening up. Game number two, live odds bet online. Astros and the Mariners, Verlander against Miranda. Astros on the road, $1.69.5 the total. Astros playing good ball again. Also helps that you got it home. Back home in Houston, you face the Mets and the big trade with the shot in the arm. Remember Keuchel's comments. A lot of guys disappointed they didn't make any moves. So they go out and get Verlander, 10-8 this year with an ERA of 3.80. Good move for the Astros. Definitely a contender in the American League again.
Of course. You know, and look, Houston, when your city is getting flooded and you're forced to play 19 straight games on the road, yeah, it can wear on you. And the Astros were a good fade last week. That's not the case necessarily right now. And the Verlander move, talk about a shot of energy for Houston. What a great move for this team at this time. And you talk about his season numbers. His season numbers are mediocre. Since the All-Star break, he's 5-2 with a 2.41 ERA. He's averaging 10.5 strikeouts per nine innings and only 2.1 walks per nine. His last three starts, 26 strikeouts, only 11 hits allowed, four walks. Average fastball velocity, 95.7. Now compare that with his average fastball velocity in recent years. 2016 was 94, 2015 was 93. The last three starts, he's been close to 96 miles an hour. Verlander's found something. His quote, obviously, this was a pretty emotional decision for me after being in one place for so long. I see this team. I've had to pitch against this team, so I know how good these guys are. The opportunity to come play for a championship caliber team, not only this year, but for the remainder of my contract, is really what it came down to. Verlander, you know, a long career in Detroit, successful career in Detroit. I think he will help Houston in their goal for a World Series title. I think he'll help them tonight knock off this Mariners squad.
So somehow, some way, the Mariners still in this. Miranda's been terrible. He has one win, an ERA of 7 since July 1st. He's had a horrible August with an ERA of 7 as well. With Paxton hurt and King Felix hurt, they don't have much in the rotation. The thing that's bailed them out has been the bullpen, when the bullpen's number 2 in WAR.
Yeah, the number 2 in WAR since the All-Star break. And look, I mean, Miranda's been terrible. You know, terrible is not the right word. He hasn't been very good, okay? And he's been lucky, which is the scariest part. He's got a 4.85 ERA for the season. Fielding Independent Pitching calls him at 5.60, just a 231 BABIP, batting average on balls in play, against Miranda this year. So he's been lucky, and his ERA is 4.85. He's up to 150 innings. This isn't a guy that has this type of track record on his arm. In 6 starts in August, he didn't even average 5 innings per start. He's only finished the 6th once in his last 10 trips to the hill. But as long as that Mariners bullpen keeps on overachieving, remember, they're number 2 in bullpen WAR since the All-Star break, behind only the Yankees. But the key is they're holding up despite being number 5 in innings pitched across that span. Normally, the best bullpens aren't the bullpens with the heaviest workloads. Wonder how long Seattle's pen is going to be able to overachieve like this before they start to wear down.
Up next, part one of part two, the deep dive. We'll look at NFL win totals and recap the openers and where they stand right now and what the markets are doing there, plus a free pick with Play of the Day on SportsBet. Betting Insight today on SBRPicks.com.
Go to SBRodds.com. Browse, compare, and shop live odds available at top online sportsbooks.
wrap it up on Sports Bet Betting Insight today. Paulie and Teddy, deep dive. Part one, final look at NFL season win totals. These are the averages from the eight books, half Vegas, half offshore, with juice factored in using the 50 cents. We'll start with the AFC today. Play of the day coming up in a second. AFC East, my God, what a horror show. The Jets are tanking. Their win total here at the South Point in Vegas is 3. You'll never see that again. The Bills might start Nathan Peterman week one against the Jets. Taylor's got a concussion, and Yates has got a concussion. The Patriots open 11 at the South Point. We're right up to 12.5. Nothing but steam there. People are talking about New England going undefeated. And then the Dolphins are stuck with Jay Cutler, Teddy.
Yeah. And let me just real quick explain this graphic. When we talk about the average for the season win totals, there are eight books factored into the equation here, 4 from Vegas, 4 from offshore. And then rather than take it, you know, 8.5 under minus 160 or whatever it is, I factor all of that and just create a number out of it where you equate 50 cents equals a half win. 50 cents worth of juice equals a half win. So what you're getting when you're looking at these graphics is the average of the books with the juice factored in, what's this team's real season win total? And basically, in the AFC East, you're talking about three teams that are basically priced at 7 wins or lower. No team, no division in the NFL is worse than the AFC East on paper. And of course, when you're talking about the New York football Jets, Paulie, we're talking about a team that has been devalued to the point of they are now being priced like the single worst team in NFL history. If the Jets are just bad, you'll make money with the Jets. However, the markets are saying they're not just bad. This team's god awful. We'll find out on Sunday because the Bills land more than a touchdown. You know, this is a Bills team that's had about as bad a preseason as you can have. To see them laying more than a touchdown against anybody stands out to me as a wager I'm not willing to make.
AFC North, Ravens with all these injuries. We'll see the health of Flacco with his back, expected to play against the Bengals. Pittsburgh, the class of this division. Browns rebuilding, starting a rookie quarterback. What do you think of the North?
Well, I mean, the very first win total recommendation we made, right when the lines first came out, we said, take Cleveland over 4. That's not going to be there. There were 4 minus 110, you know, and now it's 4.9. So we did something right with that recommendation. But when you talk about this division, we got to talk about Flacco, because in my mind, Flacco, you know, his injury and his question mark is as big an X factor in this division you can have. We know that the Ravens defense is going to be there. It's always there. You know, Baltimore defensively, they've lost a lot of personnel. I trust Ozzie Newsome to put together a good roster. But on the offensive side, Baltimore is a team that lacks skill position talent, both at wide receiver and at running back. Their offensive line's got question marks. They're a very veteran squad, and their QB's been hurt throughout the course of the preseason. I'd watch Flacco very carefully over the next couple of weeks. The opener at Cincinnati certainly stands out to me as one you want to pay attention to.
To the South, a lot of hype with the Titans, and rightfully so. They get weapons for Mariota. The Colts are a dumpster fire with Luck. Who knows when he's going to play or practice? They have to trade for Brissett. Our stats guy has Tolzien, the worst backup in the league. Jacksonville, good luck with Bortles. And Houston, they're an intriguing team. They continue to win games and make the playoffs with bad quarterback play. And here it's going to be Savage to get the start. If he falters, they have the rookie Watson.
Yeah, but the whole thing with Savage is, I mean, Savage has been giving ample opportunity at the NFL level to win a job. And basically, every time the Texans have had a chance to say, all right, Savage is going to be our guy, they've gone and got somebody else. You know, no, let's get Osweiler. No, let's move up and draft Watson. You know, there's no confidence in Houston with Tom Savage. And that's, of course, you know, why we've seen a clear separation. Remember, the Colts, the Texans, and the Titans were all priced in almost the same range to open up the campaign. Look at the difference now, with Tennessee a clear wise guy choice. And as you mentioned, Indianapolis with the continuing Andrew Luck injury situation. And this has a potential to be, you know, linger on. We don't know how long. But now Tolzien's not the worst backup in the NFL. Now he's the worst starter in the NFL, although the Jets might have something to say with that. That being said, we've seen Indy's numbers crater in basically every category. We haven't. I didn't put up the odds to win the playoffs, or odds to make the playoffs, I should say, the graphics on here. I thought it would be a little bit too much to cover in one segment. But you want to see a team whose odds to make the playoffs have absolutely tanked, that'd be the Indianapolis Colts. The markets are betting against Indy hand over fist right now.
AFC West, I think 9-7 wins this division. Raiders and Chiefs, number one in turnover margin, plus 16. Raiders have a tough schedule. I think the Chiefs missed the playoffs. Denver, maybe 8-8, 9-7 as well. They have some holes. And the Chargers, now River, I think Rivers has a big year, but they're not going to have a home field advantage again. They couldn't even get 22,000 for their first two home preseason games at the StubHub Center.
But the Chargers are the team that the wise guys seem to love here in Las Vegas. There's been a lot of pro-Charger sentiment. As I'm talking to guys around town, there seems to be a fair bit of love for this Charger squad, which tells me also that that opener on Monday Night Football at Denver, that line's likely to come down. If you like San Diego, grab the plus 3.5 now. That may not be there forever, but we got to talk the Raiders. You know, this is a squad that literally won every close game last year. They had a ton of breaks go in their direction. Now it's a franchise on the move. And you talked about them finishing with the best turnover margin in the NFL, tied with KC last year. The Chiefs are built to win turnover margins. You know, their offense is very conservative. They don't make a lot of risky plays. And the defense is built on forcing turnovers. That's not the case in Oakland. Oakland was number one in turnover margin last year, despite the fact that their offense takes a ton of shots and their defense isn't built to create turnovers. I might expect that to come back down to earth in 2017. Oakland, not a team I'm particularly bullish on.
NFC tomorrow with part two. That leads us to the play of the day. Raiders under 9.5 wins. They started with the big comeback, well, the two-point conversion to beat the Saints on the road to start. They had the come-from-behind win against the Ravens. They beat Tampa Bay in overtime on a walk-off touchdown. They had the game against the Chargers where they botched the snap and the hold. So every close game went the Raiders' way. They have a tough schedule in a tough division. Under 9.5 play of the day, Raiders win total under here on Sportsbet. Football's here. We're back tomorrow. College football, NFL. We'll check you then on Sportsbet. Betting Insight today on SBRPicks.com.